bird-based plan like we are. The raven is, you know, sort of the overarching symbol of most typical North Coast art, and their plans are generally organized under two major totems, either the raven or the eagle are the two most common general plan characters. And raven is, he's kind of this sort of consummate trickster,
yeah.
But he's also a friend to humans, real bright light, and so there's just, a myriad of stories of raven, and raven shows up a number of places throughout our work, and it kind of represents thinking, sort of a cleverness, being really resourceful in the use of materials. So most of what we do here is salvaged in one way or another. A lot of this stuff came out of schools that were being torn down, or roofs that were torn off of houses. So there's a whole idea that we don't just go out and buy new wood all the time, and we continually recycle what we have in place. And so that kind of character in that piece. Next couple of figures up, Dragonfly. Dragonfly is Emery Blackwell's totem, who is a really significant part of our community here. Met Emery back in 1982, and he wanted to take a sauna, and we realized that was pretty difficult for a man with Emery's physical challenges, and we had to carry him in and out of sauna, and actually made a commitment at that time that someday we would get a chance to build a sauna that Emery would be fully accessible. So every decision that's made here in terms of use of this facility always has a question in it, which is, can Emery use it? And because Emery can use it, it actually means that the whole space is that much more open for everybody and that much more inclusive. So the fact that the sauna is accessible is not a barrier to anyone's use of it. It just opens up the door for more people to use it. And Emery, really plays a really significant role here, just in, not only in that consciousness, but just in sort of seeing capacity where you might only see disability, and seeing strength in places where you might not necessarily think it's there, which is one of the reasons why they used to say low man on the totem pole, but we actually think that the most powerful figures in our clan are really at the bottom, and that's why Emery is distinguished there. Right above Emery is Beaver, and Beaver is it's the working totem, and it represents Lynn Colley, who's been part of this for many, many years. Beaver is her totem. And it's that whole idea that beyond, you got the whole construction of this thing, which is one world, and I think the fair as well understands that. But then there is the nourishment, and there is those kinds of taking care that happens in cooking and other ways. And so that really is kind of captured in Beaver. And there'll be a big stainless tray with copper items on it that will fit into that slot right there over time. And then there's Dog. That is actually a Samoyed dog. And just after we got the pole, a very good friend of mine who was diagnosed with a significant ovarian cancer had this just huge love of these dogs over time, and asked if it could be part of this pole. And it really harkened back to this special relationship between animals and humans, and particularly between dogs and humans, that kind of transcends a lot of other kinds of relationships. We thought it was really important that character be part of the pole. And then Loon, which is really a symbol of hopefulness and also kind of dependability. And loons are, they mate for life, and their patterns are incredibly predictable. They arrive at the same time. They have just this really tremendous strength of continuity, also hopefulness. And so that is really a lot of the children of our group, we think of in that way. And within this character, you can see the child within the moon. And that's this notion of the next generations, which is really where more and more of the focus of this work came to be. So how do you pass it on? How do you pass on the kinds of values that Emery has taught us, or the kinds of thinking that creates a space like this, that is really a healthy place. And how do you move that on to the next generation? So moon represents that. The frog, frog is it's just a wonderful character. You know, it's got a certain humor to it, but it was also proof positive of the legends of transformation, that things can change from one to another, and that all things have that capacity to alter. So the frog, of course, you know, from age to tadpole to adult frog, is proof that transformation occurs. And so many of the legends and characters is really about that kind of evolution and thinking. The next character up is Sasuto, which happens to be the character that I've always felt an affinity for. It's a truly mythical creature, so they don't exist in the normal realm, but they're part of like a parallel universe almost. There's sort of a magicness about it. They have great capacity on both ends of the equation, so tremendous creativity, but it can also be interestingly destructive. And so there's constantly this battle for that balance. And change themselves into canoes and other things. You could tell it's my symbol because it's missing this digit. and there are a pair of snakeheads that attach to that that are a port 10 steel. And then the next characters up are really this sort of tribute to the workers. And on this side there is a woman above and man below, and on the other side it is man above and woman below. And it really speaks to the great interest in the equality of this place, that, you know, that there is value in everyone that comes here, and there are aspects here that are really dominated by female energy, and there are aspects that are very dominated by a male energy, but together they make for this worker. And so you see the arms and the hands, and there will be tools that will go into those various parts of these. So this is a working part of it, and it really, in many ways, I mean, that's what the fair, that's what it's all about, is this notion of a community coming together, and, you know, the work of our head and hand to make this thing actually happen. And these are characters that you know, strongly represent that idea of work. And then the next one up is the jaguar, and this actually was Aaron's character, and in some ways embodied in that the tragedy of that accident. Beaten over around his father, spent a fair amount of time carving on that as well, and so, you know, there's that connection to that tragedy and to his son in the log. And then, of course, our totem character, the flamingo. Way back when Sauna first started in 1976, we sort of had this kind of Art Nouveau notion, and, you know, we thought about having top hats and that kind of character of it. And that was before I'd been introduced or fell in love with this particular art form. And we got to thinking, we called ourselves the flamingos. And we said, well, you know, had there been flamingos in the Pacific Northwest, and how might the native people totemize them? And so this is really an exercise at doing that. Underneath of that, you can see some arms, and these are actually arms that are raised in the wrestler sign of victory, you know, where you, when you win, your hand is raised. And it is a tribute to, so for 15 years, I was the head wrestling coach at Sakajin High School and at Roosevelt Middle School, and many of those young men learned to be workers, you know, here at Fair. And there are a number of them that are still involved in which field that did the engineering. Chris Kent, who began working for me as a wrestler in the sixth grade at Roosevelt Middle School, and was on my team throughout his high school years, and was out here for over almost 30 years, and was, you know, one of the men that was lost in that accident. So it's kind of that kind of connection. And then there's a heart just beneath the beak of the bird. Interestingly enough, Brad Bolton and myself and Captain White all lost our mothers this year. And there was a capturing of that heart component. We thought that it nestled there on the breast of flamingo was a good place to keep that safe and hold that memory. And in the very top of the pole are the three watchmen, kind of the classic watchmen. See the parrot there in the middle, with a fierce beak but no teeth, representing our very own. But there, you know, this is kind of the very top of the pole, looking in all directions, watching for harm that might come this way or opportunities that might come this way. Tragically, this year, my sister's daughter passed away, and we made a plug in the very top of the pole, and some of her ashes were contained in that plug. So that's, this side of the pole, and much of it is replicated on both sides. But there's just really a huge amount of spirit connected here. People are compelled to touch it. And it's just been a really wonderful experience to watch people participate. And we've invited people to carve on it, and many, many people did. And I think there's a sense of ownership by the community here in a pretty unique way. I mean, most art kind of happens here, and there are artists that do it, and it sort of, arrives, and it's wonderful and spectacular, but there's been more of an interface and more of a invitation to participate in this one. And we had carving stations set up, and lots of people came and sort of played at using the carving tools, and folks participated. And I just spent a lot of time out here this year watching people combine. You just can't help yourself but touch this thing. I had a great experience Saturday night. I was sitting back, we had some seats out here, and there was a light on the pole, and a woman came up and stood at the very bottom of the pole and closed her eyes, and then for an hour just explored this pole from its texture. And the textures of this pole are so amazing, from the fur of the grizzly bear to the texture of the beaver, the otter. There's incredible detail in the otter. It's a tactile experience that was really neat, and just to watch her do that and kind of feel it and interpret it was really a joy. And it spoke to me as to how much this particular art piece has just sort of up from the grassroots kind of quality to it. In all honesty, I never imagined that it would be what it has become. I mean, I had this idea, kind of a big idea. Oh, I'll do a totem pole, right? But it got away, and it really became something far more intricate, emotional. There's a lot of connective tissue there than I ever imagined. And as you can well appreciate, it's also been a lot of expense. The wings will be here behind the flamingo.
Not 12 from foot. The back?
Yeah, on the back, on the back of the pole.
Will they be steel?
They're stainless and copper. Kenny Hartenbrook, who is the head pipe fitter and teak welder for the Springfield Creamery, has been working on them for almost 3 years. The material alone for the wings is almost $3,500, just the material. Not to mention the hundreds of hours that it's taken to craft them. I mean, you got to imagine something that's sticking out there that far, that is welded and fabricated and braced in a way that it withstand wind forces and so forth. And they'll actually be permanently attached to the steel column. You can see that the bottom backside of the pole is hollowed out, which is one of the first things we did, and it helps control the cracking of the pole. But also then it'll allow it to nestle into that steel pipe, and then there'll be three through bolts that'll solidly fasten it to the pipe, and it'll sit up off of the base. So it should last, 100 years. I mean, what really kills them is burying them in the ground. And then right away the moisture starts to attack them. And
George, are you planning on having like a interpretive sign or something?
Yeah.
With all what you just said.
Yeah. No, we do
so
it.
So it'd be nice to have something visual as well for people.
No, absolutely, and that's been talked about. And also, there's a lot of a way of kind of capturing memory. And there's been a number of people, with all of us, as we grow older, we lose our friends. And there are people that were parts of this sauna for many, many years, and you know, we want to memorialize that. And we're thinking that, you know, within the base, those things can continue to happen. And it is a story, and I think it's an evolving one. And our dream for this area was that this would be the first of other things that would be carved here. I mean, it's sort of begun to be thought of as a place where that happens, where there's, you know, active art happening. And we had blocks out here, and actually, you know, a guy that was an art teacher out of Alaska came and just, you know, not in any way controlled by us, he just showed up here and then spent whole days here teaching kids to carve. So there's a thing about this space, you know, in terms of that expressive art that I think we want to continue to be a part of, and maybe help make other, you know, poles or other pieces of art that move in into the fair. And it's a, you know, this end of the fair, I mean, as path people, you know, I mean, it there's a quality about, you know, here being able to get out of the heavy traffic of it all. It's pretty sweet, and we really embrace that, you know, in kind of the spaces that we created in the seating, is that idea that there's a little bit of a quieter eddy here. There's not quite so much going on. But, you know, anyway, the other characters, Frog again, being Gary Ford, and Man and Woman and the Worker, Susumu. The otter is just, you know, you get a chance to look, just tremendous detail. And Brad Bolton, who was the head artist of the pole, was actually working on otter when he got the phone call that his mother had passed away, and his mother was a Pisces, and so Pisces showed up. And it's just, you know, it is that whole, so interesting to talk to people about, you know, how they saw this thing. And I can't emphasize enough that in a way it's a project that really has gotten away from me, and that's kind of cool too, because I have a tendency to try to control things a little too much. This I really don't, and so I feel like I'm kind of along for the ride on this. Otter actually represents my daughter, and grizzly bear, and Bobby Alvo. So it's, you know, it's characters that you can attach that happen to be Sonic characters, but they could be anybody's characters. You know, I think the totemography of it all is all of us. I mean, it is the fair. And we feel it's a great, it's a gift. And in many ways, it's a gift to have been able to do it, and we hope that the fair sees it in that way too.
Mm-hmm. Well, I definitely feel it is a gift. Like I mentioned in the previous path planning meeting when we were discussing, my family and especially my kids have been down here, and I thought that gentleman was brought here by you. Because they spent a good couple hours with my daughter and who's a 13-year-old, really, that was probably one of her highlights of the fair, was to sit down here and spend some time carving and listening to him talking about carving. And being able to bring this and watch this evolve, especially in light of the accident that happened, it did take on a different tone. And very powerful for a lot of people. I like the idea that he spoke to about another totem that is more fair-centric. But that speaks to gives us the opportunity to speak a different story. And as this story evolves, it sounds like it has continually been on an evolutionary process all the way up to where we are at right now, which is amazing to hear. And I've been wanting to have somebody explain this to me, and that's amazing. So,
well, Brad does a really beautiful job of it. Like I say, he's carved on this pole continuously for 7 months.
Yeah.
It's an amazing amount of time on the tour. He'll be back in May of next year. We'll move it soon. The logging guy.